Hello and welcome to Midweek Matters. There are reports in news outlets that have special access to the ruling party that the Prime Minister is planning a rejig of his cabinet, that he is assessing his ministers' functioning. The exercise is unlikely to yield much result. It is clear from the beginning that he has very limited pool of talent in his party to choose from. Some additions, some droppings, and some changes of portfolios of the existing ministers may be necessary, but they will not amount to much except to send a message that the Prime Minister seeks performance from his ministers. Except a few, most of his ministers bring neither professional competence nor lend political weight to the cabinet anyway. Upcoming state elections might necessitate some induction from those states to beef up his party's prospects. But there are two aspects that deserve his serious attention. Today, I will speak about them. One, he must introspect if he and the omnipotent PMO are allowing the ministers to actually function with any reasonable amount of freedom. An impression has gained ground that there is little initiative possible by even those who are capable of taking it. The best judge whether this is true or not is the Prime Minister himself. If true, he must address it and make what is now a collection of ministers into a team of performers. India needs that now much more than ever before. The second important thing that deserves his serious attention is policy, sound policy. Equally importantly, formulated in the right way in a democratic country like ours. In democracies, more often, bad policy arrived at by a right process does less harm than a good policy arrived at by the wrong process. COVID handling has given us a lot of lessons. If states, political opinion, and professional expertise were involved in the assessment, forecasting, policy formulation, and implementation, we could have handled the situation much more effectively. We could have avoided the vaccine mess, lakhs of deaths, economic hardship, and the shamelessly tragic sight of dead bodies floating in the holiest river of ours. There can be no two opinions about this. The belated and partial reset of the vaccine policy, if that is an indication that the government is learning to revise its policies and is prepared to shed its rigidity, it indeed is a faint ray of democratic hope. The planned all-party meeting on Jammu and Kashmir also is raising expectations that there is a change in the way issues are addressed by the government. Hope they are not belied. After all, in a democracy, a mandate once every 5 years is not to be interpreted as an unbridled license to make the government an inscrutable black box for the next 5 years. Government should be a continuous expression of the opinions, spirit, and energies of the people of our nation. If earlier governments did not do it, that is no excuse for not doing it now. Unless the ruling dispensation sees merit in being no different and better than the past governments and decides to continue its egocratic streak. There's one more important policy issue that deserves a more democratic way of addressing: the anti-farm laws agitation by our farmers. The bills were rushed through Parliament. Bills were introduced in Lok Sabha on 17th September, in the Rajya Sabha on 20th September. The President gave assent to them on 27th September 2020. Everything in just a span of 10 days. The model bills that were prepared earlier by the Centre to be circulated to the states were not properly discussed. The committee of seven chief ministers constituted to look into them has not submitted its report. In June 2020, ordinances were promulgated. By end of September, they were made into laws. There were no proper deliberations and discussion on a subject as vital and as vast as agriculture. The misgivings of the farming community were not responded to in a conciliatory manner. The agitation was sought to be demonized, portrayed as anti-national. Government talks with the farmers' organizations looked half-hearted. They came across more as meetings to convince the farmers of government's point of view than to listen to them and address their apprehensions. The Supreme Court stepped in, put the legislations on hold, and appointed a committee to go into the issues raised by the agitating farmers. It was an avoidable kick in the teeth of the government. The committee's composition did not evoke confidence in the farmers. The convener of the All India Kisan Coordination Committee, which is spearheading the protests, Bhupinder Singh Mann, who was also to be part of the committee, quit as a result. Now, let us quickly examine the proceedings of the committee. It met 23 times. 11 were its internal meetings and 12 were devoted to meeting with the stakeholders, farmers' organizations, state governments, officials of marketing boards, operators of private mandis and food parks from various states, industries associations, professionals and academics. The committee's press releases after each meeting listed the participants in the meetings. However, with two exceptions, they did not name the farmers' organizations, except the last meeting, which claimed that it met the office bearers of AIKCC, and the professionals and academicians were not named. But why? Does that not smack of opaqueness? Shouldn't the members of the committee have chosen to be transparent? The committee's portal also has a photo gallery section. It has pictures of some meetings, but all of the pictures are taken in the long shot. Participants are not clearly visible. Only those pictures that had the committee members are in close-up, sharp and clear. I have given the link to the committee's portal in the description. Do take a look at it. We do not know the contents of the report. It's submitted to the apex court in a sealed cover. With this kind of opaqueness in the working of the committee, we cannot expect it to help much in resolving the differences. Let me now draw your attention to the larger agrarian question in India. The last spirited debates and a comprehensive discussion on the agrarian question took place sometime around 1947-49 and again around 1965. Since then, agriculture gradually fell out of the attention stream of the Indian economic imagination. In the early 1970s, once again, a modicum of debate took place on the eve of the quickly aborted land reforms. After that, there is hardly any meaningful debate on a sector which absorbed the bulk of our labor force and which is vital to our economy. It is important to note some critical facts to understand the state of our agriculture. It gives us an idea about why the farmers are agitated. Their leaders may not be equipped to express themselves in sophisticated language, present their case in PowerPoint, or provide data in spreadsheets to attract the attention of the economic priesthood that is lodged in the corridors of power. Please take note of the following. After the major food crisis in 1965, Indian agriculture did well. Food production multiplied 3.7 times, our population by only 2.5 times. As a result, today we are secure on the food front. We have about 45% percent more food per person in the country. But what is the state of our farmer? Farm's family income was 34% of non-farm family income in the 1980s. Today, it is 25%. A farm family earns, on an average, just 56,510 rupees in a year from hectare of irrigated land. And from non-irrigated rain-fed hectare, the income is a meager 35,352 rupees per annum. Agriculture contributes about 16 to 17% of our GDP. When almost every sector took a beating in 2020-2021, farm sector grew by 3.6%. If not for agriculture, our GDP decline could have been much worse than the minus 7.3% in the last fiscal. Our agriculture absorbs 64% of our rural workforce, but its productivity is low compared to that of non-farm labor. The estimated worker productivity in agriculture sector is 62,235 rupees as compared to worker productivity of 1,71,587 rupees in non-farm sector during 2011-12, the last year for which data are available. Therefore, workforce in the farm sector is dwindling. Between 2004-05 and 2011-12, about 3 crore workers left agriculture. Number of cultivators too declined by 2 crores from 16.61 crores to 14.62 crores in the same period. Where did these people go? Young, old, men, women, heads of family, sons and daughters, mothers and sisters. They're unlikely to have any skills, majority of them at any rate. They would have ended up at construction sites or as untrained cheap security guards or domestic helps in the apartment complexes in our cities. Add the reported and unreported suicides of farmers to this dismal scenario to get an idea of the miserable state of our farmers. The point is, all this happened while our food production increased and we have 45% more food per person in the country produced by these very hands. And these people go to bed on most nights hungry. The farm family stands helpless, impoverished, and stares at further impoverishment. Successive governments and the economic thinking in the country couldn't care less. They were focused on investment flows, foreign capital, capital markets, Sensex, interest rates, trade liberalization, fiscal deficits, writing off of corporate debts, business roundtables, IPOs, rating agencies, their scores, ease of doing business rankings, IT, e-commerce, livable cities. Country's power elite had little time for agriculture. Only farmer suicides became newsworthy, holding our media's temporary attention. Against this backdrop, in 2017 came the announcement of government's intention to double farmers' income, giving hope for some serious attention to agriculture. NITI Aayog released a document titled Doubling Farmers' Income, Rationale, Strategy, Prospects, and Action Plan. I have given the link to it in the description below. But the document did not go beyond suggesting some technology, market, and crop diversification related strategies and action plan without addressing the core issues that bedevil the sector. There is no attempt to come to grips with the structural issues which are critical to the problem. Most disappointing and even shocking prognosis of the document is the following. It says, If the number of cultivators keeps dwindling at the same rate as experienced during 2004-5 to 2011-12, it will reduce their number by 13.4% between 2015-2023. And here comes the shocker. This implies that the available farm income will be distributed among 13.4% less farmers. The shadow text of the strategy seems more or less to let the number of cultivators dwindle so that it's easier to double the farm income as there will be less number of claimants to the agrarian pie. There are serious issues in the sector that cannot be ignored anymore. Nearly 60% of India's small and marginal farmers do not have access to institutional credit from scheduled commercial banks. About 7.5 crore farmers. This is too large a number to ignore. Even among those who could get credit from the institutional sources, 9% borrowed from private money lenders also. These small and marginal farmers operate 86% of the farm holdings, the 2015-16 agriculture census tells us. Green revolution increased food production, but at the same time pushed up the input costs of seeds, fertilizers, pesticides, made the farmers hostage to them, with very little credit available, and as a result, made them dependent on the minimum support price. Even with the MSP support, their incomes are abysmally low. We have already noted their annual incomes. The damage this model of agriculture has done to the soil, environment, biodiversity, sustainability is a much larger question that is now increasingly under focus globally. But that is for some other time. Telling these impoverished, vulnerable and small and marginal farmers that they can trade in futures, can sell their produce on e-platforms to anyone, anywhere in the country and realize better prices makes little sense to them. Most of them have no secure rights on the land. Without addressing the basic issues like credit, tenancy rights, minimum base price, to speak to them about market access is insensitivity. To throw their precarious livelihoods to big predatory corporate wolves is merciless. The government, with all its might, may be able to suppress the agitation now and go ahead with the implementation of the laws. But the question is, for whose benefit? To what effect? I will read out some points from the Charter of Demands by a Farmers Union, and I bet on anything that you won't be able to guess who put forward those demands and when. Do try if you can guess. Abolition of agriculture debts. Redistribution of all cultivable wasteland vesting in the government to subsistence farmers and landless laborers. Occupancy rights for all the tenant farmers. Marketing cooperatives to eliminate private traders. Cheap credit, seeds and fertilizers. This was the Charter of Demands of All India Kisan Sabha in 1936. Yes, in 1936, you have heard me right. AIKS was founded in Guntur in the Andhra region of the erstwhile Madras Presidency by Acharya N.G. Ranga. It organized a 200-mile march through the villages of Bombay Presidency that ended as an open session attended by 40,000 farmers in Faizpur. 40,000 farmers marching 200 miles in 1936. The point is, those demands of the farmers are still unmet. That is the issue to be addressed by the government if it wants to usher in a new dawn in the lives of farmers, double their income, and make India a $5 trillion economy. The neoliberal critics who dominate our economic establishment do not receive wisdom from anywhere other than a few select Western universities from the corridors of IMF and World Bank. Their eyes are soon shut to the East. They should look at the experience of Japan, China, South Korea, Taiwan, and Vietnam. These countries addressed their agrarian question, undertook redistribution of land, made family farms, gave secured land rights, encouraged financial institutions to supply credit. That was the origin of the cycle of their economic development and manufacturing. Their countryside teemed with small owner cultivators rather than insecure tenant farmers, squatters, and landless laborers. Agriculture yields rose by 50 to 60%. Farm incomes rose by 100 to 150% in those countries. Yes, 100 to 150%. We have something to learn from such experiences, but our economic thinking is unfamiliar with economists like Wolf Ladejinsky. He was an American consultant in East Asia immediately after the Second World War. Not a communist. His ideas catalyzed these initiatives. World Bank published his selected papers on the unfinished business of agrarian reform. I've given the link to the World Bank's portal that has his work. Please take a look. You will find that his ideas are no different from the 1936 All India Kisan Sabha's Charter of Demands. Our government is strong. Our Prime Minister, despite the COVID mess, still has substantial political capital. But this strength and capital should not be squandered to ride out the storms like the farmers' agitation. Nor should it be used to forcing laws on the nation that would willy-nilly favor big corporates and food speculators. Mind you, it's food, not just any other commodity. What is good for the farmer is good for the country. Without prosperous farmers, we cannot have a prosperous India. They create wealth, put food on our table. They don't run away to Antigua and London. Cabinet rejigs are far less important than policy reset, especially the farm law reset. That's all we have time for today. Thanks for your attention. We'll be back again next week, Wednesday, lunchtime at 1 o'clock. Do stay safe and take really good care of yourselves and all your loved ones. Until then, bye.